After very enlightening presentations in the morning and now of theory, I am going to present a little exercise of exploring how much wastewater is used for irrigation with a very limited scope of looking at only that in state of Gujarat. As a background, I would also give water supply scenario and the sanitation scenario in the major cities of Gujarat. Gujarat has, as per 2011 census, 168 municipalities consisting of A, B and C class cities and metropolitan cities. Metropolitan cities are the cities which have a population about 10 lakhs. 10 lakhs is 10 lakhs. As it was explained in the morning, that the sewage treatment capacities are much lower. And the sewage, whether it is treated or untreated, is discharged either into water bodies or into open lands. And contamination is caused because of that. On the other hand, when we travel around the country, we see that a lot of irrigation is being done with this wastewater. Whether it is treated or untreated is not known. So this was an exercise to explore that. Also, the objective is to bring back the attention to wastewater, which all of us have been trying now, and give it its importance it deserves, and also see that in future it's going to increase a lot, so we have to be cautious now. It was very surprising for me to know that this is very familiar with the farmers there, and they call it sewage farming. Mm-hmm. It's like a term which they use every day. Although this is out of the scope of the study, but I do realize that there are public health risks involved with the wastewater use for irrigation.
So what do they say in the local language?
Sewage farming. Sewage farming.
Okay.
In Gujarati.
In Gujarati.
Yes, yes. They say sewage farms and sewage farm.
Okay.
Not sewage farming, but sewage farms.
Okay.
The fields which farm with sewage water. The risks, Priyani has mentioned some Sunita has mentioned in the morning, but I am not going to talk about these because I have not considered these. As I wanted to capture the bulk of wastewater used for irrigation in the city of Gujarat, I took this assumption that the cities which have larger population would use most of drinking water and would generate most sewage water. So I sampled the cities which were largest and also which had most of network complete to collect the sewage. I found out of 8 corporations, 2 corporations did not have sewage network. Junagadh has 0 sewage network and everything is, all the toilets are connected to either septic tanks and most often to soak pits. In Jamnagar it's 14%. 14% network is there but which could be neglected. So rest of the 6 corporations are considered. In addition, we have also considered Bhuj city because of its location. Bhuj is located in the district of Kutch, which is very arid. And therefore, it has lot of water scarcity and assumes a it's very, very important to study that city because whatever sewage would be generated is valuable for the farmers. So that was as a special case taken as a sample. After screening the cities, we did a reconnaissance visit in the cities to identify the STPs with the municipal corporation officers and mark the STPs on the map. Then we did a transect that wherever the water is disposed, where is it going. And then we did PRS with the farmers to find out how much water is used for irrigation from, I mean, a total area which is irrigated in a village and out of it, how much percentage is used by wastewater. After that we accumulated it and also talked to each of the village for understanding their income generation out of those agricultural produces. We use satellite images to do this. I'll be coming to that now. From the corporations what we found is this. This is 2011 data. The total water supply in the cities is this. And required sewage treatment capacities, 80% of it is this. Available treatment capacities, there are deficits and there are surpluses.
In spite of this, that wherever there are surpluses like Ahmedabad and Gandhinagar, we will find that sewage is not treated because of various reasons. The CAG reports report about Gujarat like this, that out of 168, if there is a mistake, there are 168 URBs. Almost 93% ULBs discharge it out in open, they don't treat it. 9 ULBs put it in the lakes, in groundwater 18 ULBs, in the open land 46, rivers 40, natural drains 26, and sea creeks 9 ULBs, which are on coast. 8 ULBs are reported in CAG report, which sell the treated water for generating some revenues. Although there is surplus in Ahmedabad city, we find that there are plans to increase the sewage treatment capacities. Now this was difficult to understand. Was it for future or what was the reason? I do not know. Even in Rajkot, already surplus is there, but still they are planning to increase the capacities. In spite of this, we will find that the sewage is not treated as per GPCB. Now Gujarat Pollution Control Board or any control, any pollution control board in any city does check, does monitoring for the pollution in the rivers. They do report it to the municipalities, but they do not have teeth enough to tell anything to municipalities. Even if municipality doesn't take any action, any pollution control board cannot do anything. They will just report it to municipalities and municipality would put it aside. That is the norm. So what is happening? As per GPCB has records, what is happening? GPCB says that total treatment capacity in Ahmedabad is 1075 MLD. Total sewage received as per record is only 730, which is much lesser than actually, you know, yeah. Actual sewage treatment, although you know the treatment capacities are so much, the treatment is only of 455 MLD. Sewage bypass, they are reporting that so much sewage is bypassed, although sewage treatment capacity is there, sewage treatment plants are there, everything is there, and generation is 900 MLD. As per unofficially given information by the AMC, there are 59 STPs. 9 STPs are for domestic sewage. Rest of them are established by either GIDC, the Industrial Development Corporations, or other industrial associations to treat their industrial effluents. But we also find that most of them are not working. We'll see the map of Ahmedabad here. One of the findings is this, that when we did a transect in most of the cities, that all the STPs are the aggregating points of the sewage. The sewage gets aggregated where the STPs are located. It could be bypassed, it could be passed through that, or it could be treated. All the three things are possible, but the aggregation points remain the STPs. They are the aggregation points, and from there, most of the cities which I studied had the conveyance through the rivers or the nalas, except for some cities, which I will mention later. So in Ahmedabad, what happens is the STPs are located on the banks of Sabarmati, and the treated, untreated water is released into the river. Then we tracked along the river to find out how many villages are using wastewater. And we found almost 45 villages using wastewater. Although there is STP on the other side, wind zone, where you can see on top, there is a STP there, but there are lots of industries there. So they also put in dispose of industrial wastewater into the river there. So farmers understand it. They don't use it because the pH of that water is 2, 3, it's highly acidic in nature. So although they do not have irrigation water at all, Narmada canal doesn't reach there, still they do not use this water. It's completely contaminated. What I found very interesting is this, that the wastewater is used not today. It's 40 to 70 year old in India. Yeah. And there are institutions formed around this. There are cooperatives which are formed to use wastewater for irrigation. In Ahmedabad, for example, in 1955, just after independence, on the periphery of Ahmedabad, the AMC, the municipality, gave land and water together on lease to farmers to grow fodder. 660 hectares of land was given to 260 farmers. To manage that, they formed this Shri Sewage Sarkari Mandali Limited. The cooperative itself has the name of Sewage and Water Limited. So it's very, very obvious. But this cooperative was formed much later. Everything was okay, but around 1985, the AMC wanted the land back for expansion of city and putting in more treatment plants and other uses. These people did not want to give it because the asset value of the land had increased many folds by then. So they went to the court of law, and at that point in time they formed this cooperative so that they can file the case in court unitedly. Still that cooperative exists and deals with AMC collectively. Similar cases found in literature in Kanpur city.
Also in Kochi. We should also look at Trivandrum.
Same sewage farming.
Yeah.
Lots of cities have. Okay. And this was actually part of Ganga Action Plan in that time. What was happening in Kanpur.
Very interesting.
They thought this is a very convenient way of disposing the water by the cities. So their farmers use it, yeah. Another lift irrigation scheme was formed on the banks of river again by three villages, Navapura, Miroli, Timba, four villages and Palki. In 1952, it is still operational and making huge profits. It's really profitable for them. They have built a canal to bring the wastewater from the river to their farms, which cost something like 34 lakhs. That's the capital cost of that canal to bring in wastewater. They also have assets like pumps and they are farming on 1200 hectares. Prior to the Narmada water being brought in Sabarmati, what used to happen was all the water of Sabarmati only would flow further to these villages along with the sewage water. So there was fresh water into it. It was not pure sewage. So that was better for crops. Meaning that only sewage plus fresh water is not so good as we will see in other cities, but because industrial effluents are coming in, it was diluting the contamination of industrial effluents, and that was good for crops. But now farmers feel after 2000, when industrial effluents are going and fresh water is not coming in because of the dam, the productivity has gone down. One of the points which was mentioned in the earlier presentations was that there is unaccounted water supply from the domestic side. But I felt, at least in Ahmedabad and Vadodara, the cities which are very, very industrial, that the unaccounted water being used by the industries is much higher than the domestic use. In Ahmedabad, what we found is on the periphery, there are these industrial associations, there are many. I looked at three of them. And they house something like 3,500 industries, and I tracked two of them just informally to find out how much water they are withdrawing. And I found that they have 700 plus 350, around 1,000 bore wells of a depth of 700 to 1,000 feet, drawing water which would be almost equivalent to what is the water supply to Ahmedabad city. So it's doubling it, and they are disposing it after that. So it is 1000 MLD this and 1000 MLD from the water supply departments. Also which we read is this, that 8% of freshwater withdrawal as against 4% earlier. So this is going on increasing, and more so that the peripheries of the cities are converted into industrial zones. So it's very easy for them to practically just bury a bore well and extract water, otherwise they are not going to get permissions. Now the actual part of study. This was just like that. It was not done as part of study.
So give us a sense of the time you need.
I think 10 minutes.
Okay. village-wise estimates of the agricultural area, receipts and cash profits were prepared through focus group discussions. Okay. I'll go a little faster. This is Bhavnagar. Each city has a story. Now Bhavnagar, Bhavnagar had one STP, built in 1940, pre-independence. This was the first STP of Gujarat, built by the king. It was operational in 1998. After that it stopped because it has its own life. Nothing has replaced it till date. There is no STP now, no treatment in Bhavnagar. There were two oxidation ponds for primary treatment made in another area in Bhavnagar, but they are not functioning. But however, we saw that the sewage is getting aggregated in these two places. Here also sewage farming is done since 1940, since the STP was established there by the king. People are using the treated water and now untreated water since STP doesn't exist. So they are using the untreated water. There is a 100 HP pump there and they are paying water charges, 120 rupees per liter, to the mandali for maintenance and operation. In Bhuj, till recently, around 3 years back, the sewage was collected in two water bodies in the city itself. As the city grew, population grew, sewage grew, and the water bodies didn't have the capacities to collect the sewage. So it was put in the Khari River, which flows through Bhuj into another village called Nagaur. Nagaur farmers are very happy because Khari River didn't have any water earlier. Only in flash floods they used to have water for a week in a year. Now they have water and they look at Bhuj city, how much water is supplied to them, accordingly they sow their crops. There is another example in Bhuj, is use of B-watts. There are plans put up to use all the wastewater generated by Bhuj city and green the city. And phase one is complete. This is done by Hunarshala Foundation. Phase one is complete, in which they are using 30,000 liters per day and 95,000. Two D-watts plants are put up. Rest of it is still going into Khari River. In Gandhinagar. Gandhinagar, there are 8 villages, 1 STP. Now, the STP water was being released into Gota. Gota area is now within Ahmedabad city. So, Gota residents complained of smell or whatever. So, the AMC had to change the plan and redo the pipeline to take it through these villages. So, the first village, Jasper, was not getting the sewage water because of this, because they planned to change the network. Jasper village raised an objection and they said no, they would want to have the sewage water for irrigation. AMC decided that they would be supplying sewage water to Jasper farmers by keeping a pipeline till Jasper village ends and put a dead end there so that those people can use through the pipeline and the rest of the water would go. The earlier plan was to release it into Thol Lake, but MOEF objected to it. And eventually they decided to put it in the last village, Jetlaj. There is a pond. Whenever there are flash floods, the storm water also gets collected and therefore it goes into Jetlaj Lake. Otherwise it doesn't reach there. Farmers use it up before that. This is Rajkot. Rajkot is very interesting again. Because in Rajkot, what has happened is there are dams on this river Aji which flows through the city. Some of the dams are reserved for drinking water and rest of them are for irrigation. So the dams which are reserved for drinking water, those are safe. After that, the sewage is released into the river itself and then it goes to Aji 2 and 3, which are irrigation dams. So most of the dam actually is filled with sewage water. But I suspect the sewage is not treated. Because when we spoke with the STPs, they showed us the way they bypass it. I do not know the quantities, how much they bypass. Farmers also are very happy because of the nutritional value of the sewage generated. Almost the productivity increases 1.4 to 2.4 times. And they have good markets because of proximity to the city.
there are also cooperatives there. Again, sewage water lift irrigation, Manjali. It's recognized by the corporation, because corporation is maintaining lifting of this water and using it for irrigation. They pay money to corporation, and corporation, there is a MOU done. In fact, they used to lift water from a from a lake called Lalpari Lake, which that time they used to go for irrigation water. Later, Rajkot wanted it for drinking water use, so that they asked the farmers not to use it for irrigation. So they did a MOU. That means that they will get the sewage water, and they agreed that MOU still exists. So it's a recognized thing by the corporation that sewage is being used for irrigation. This is one example of one city. I'm just showing it. Later on, I'll show the cumulative figures only. This is one city around Rajkot. That how have we calculated it? These are the name of the villages where we visited. Then we found out from each village what is the net irrigated area we found from the remote sensing images in Rabi season, so that we know that it's irrigated. Then net wastewater irrigated area, we calculated this with focus group discussions. Then gross wastewater irrigated area, after knowing from them that how many crops they are taking, we calculated this. Then agriculture receipts, again from them, these three things through the farmers, and then we calculated cash profits. I'm not calling it net profits because I'm not taken into account the family labor and the cost for the land debt. Surat. Now Surat is a water abundant city. It has lots of STPs. It has surplus capacity, but it doesn't have land to use the water which is disposed. So water after treatment goes into sea. It is not being used. They are going to put up a tertiary plant also in 2 years. And that water also after treatment is going to go into sea.
No, that they are selling off to industry. So they just gave us a plan saying that they are putting up a tertiary treatment actually with the BOT, because their cost of water supply to industries is very high.
Yes.
And they're selling water at almost 50 rupees. So the treatment, it's very economical to put up a tertiary treatment to sell to industry.
That's what the industry feels, that
yeah. 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 Because it will be at about 21 rupees as compared to 50 rupees that they're buying it at.
Okay. Right now it has not come up, it's just at the planning stage.
It's at
just
acquired the land.
Yeah. That's right.
But they said it was economical, so let's see. If it works out, it will be very interesting.
It would be the first case like that.
The first case in Gujarat.
Absolutely.
Probably it has happened in Chennai. Chennai is very small and very old, this thing. So this will be really I think it will be a game changer.
Surat is quite advanced, I felt, in many ways.
Very advanced.
But yeah, again, they are also, what I also felt that, you know, in some of the farmers, it could have been used, the water is going waste after treatment. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know what use it could have been put to, either meaning the city or some other use. And in any case, although there it is a canal irrigated area, but still wherever the canals are not reaching, still I found some acreage being irrigated with wastewater, which is very less. In Baroda. Baroda, there is this effluent channel project which carries the industrial effluents and goes some 70-80 kilometers. I have not considered that, but only the other sewage which is generated through domestic use. However, but also apart from the industrial effluent which goes into ECP, there is industrial effluent which is being put into the river also, Vishwamitri River. Ahmedabad and Baroda, both the cities, reported that because of the industrial effluents being put into the river and being used for irrigation, the productivity is reducing a lot. And also the complaint of heavy metals entering into the sewage. They also said that whenever wastewater is being used for irrigation, the best crop to grow is fodder.
because fodder is tolerant to detergents and other chemicals, one, and also that they feel that it grows much faster with sewage water because of higher nutrient in it. This is one example of a cropping pattern in one of the cities. It's almost typical. I mean, the crops change, but you will see the land will not remain fallow for a long time. It's just fallow for 2 months where it has to dry up because you are constantly irrigating it. It has to dry up before the next sowing. So that's all. So they almost take multiple crops throughout the year. We also found some examples where treatment facilities are put up and the treated water is sold. Villages, I thank Umesh Bhai for this information. Umesh Bhai had told me to visit these villages and see it. So I went to these villages and found that annual auctions are held in these villages. They have a small treatment capacity and it's working very well. It's not very old, put up by Wasmo. And they auction it every year, and the auction, the amount they get is ₹5,000 to ₹11,000.
Where are these villages?
In Kutch.
All in Kutch.
Yeah. The land irrigated is 2 hectare, 5.5 hectare and 4.5 hectares. The amount depends on when the auctioning is done and if the rains are delayed. If the rains are delayed and farmers need the water, then the amount what they get is more. Although the treatment facilities really do not require any kind of maintenance a lot. They just need to be cleaned and this amount is quite a bit for that. But they use it for cleaning the sewage networks, which requires some money. So it is sufficient for that. There are other municipalities. I have not found details of it yet. But I have also found, like I mentioned earlier, that in Bhavnagar, in Gandhinagar, in Rajkot, treated water is sold, municipality is generating revenue out of it. Other than that, also there are other municipalities like Nadiad, Port, Palitana, Patan, Balasinod and Visnagar. These are reported by municipalities. Now this is accumulation, what is the economy it generates? In all the 7 cities which I studied, the number of villages which are using wastewater for irrigation is 94. Net irrigated area in hectare is almost 38,000. The gross would be 17,000. So if you, no, sorry, net irrigated area is along with fresh water and wastewater use. This is fresh wastewater use. So almost half of it is wastewater use. In a village, we also have to see this, that the wastewater is not accessible till the end of the village. It would be accessible only where the conveyance channel is there. 2 kilometers from there, they can take the pipeline. Beyond that, they will have to either use groundwater or any other means. So there is this difference because this is a village-wise study. The wastewater irrigated gross area is 27,000 and wastewater irrigated net area is 17,000. So it's almost like 1.4 to 2.4 ratio I am getting between these. The agriculture receipts are 184 crores and cash profit out of it is very high because of two reasons, that they are taking crops all around the year. They sell the vegetables at a very high cost because transport cost is negligible for them, and it's very, very productive. The cauliflower, the rose and other vegetables, fodder, it's very, very productive. Ratio, which Priyani mentioned, I used her method and I tried to see that what are the ratios I am getting out of this. There are various reasons for this, clearly. You will see the variation between 0.1 to 18. Okay, now this is because I have not considered the fresh water. It's pure wastewater irrigation only. But this variation is like in Surat, you know, the ratio is very low because people are not using wastewater. So it will not be a constant. In Gandhinagar, in the water scarce areas like Rajkot, like Bhuj, it will be very high. But it will not be a constant. It will depend on the typology of the city. If it's a coastal city, the land is not available, so ratio will become low.
if it's a water scarce area, the ratio will go very high. So it would keep varying because according to the typology of the city. The farmers' suggestions. What we have found from the municipalities is that there are 74 cities in Gujarat which are considering sewage network. The first step in management of sewage is sewage network, which I think at least state of Gujarat is considering that way, and they do not really promote a STP unless and until sewage network is in place. So there are 74 cities. No. I would say I would go by this.
By your fancy words of your Gujarati.
No, I'm only mentioning this one point. 74 cities have already proposed to put up the sewage network plan, but not the STPs. Okay. So, and STPs would come along after that, the next step. It's not done. So the proposal is this. So the farmers are saying that, farmers also know that sewage network is going to be done. Even in those villages of Kutch where we found the sewage network was done first and then the STP was put up. They say that they should consider and put the STP in such a way that we can use the water.
Exactly.
Very simple thing. They're planning to. Secondly, they also say that impact of use of wastewater on soil, like hardening of topsoil, especially with detergents and other chemicals, they do not know how to deal with that. Third is they also say that decentralized treatment of wastewater will be more useful because you can actually use larger areas. They, like in Bhuj, because they are using it very recently, last 3 years only, they really do not know how much nutrient is present in sewage. So they still apply fertilizers. In other villages, we have found that they have stopped using fertilizers and therefore the profits were very high.
Very interesting.
Yeah. Micro irrigation. In Bhavnagar, they said that they are using wastewater for 70 years. They said if we can use micro irrigation, maybe we can irrigate more, but it chokes up. Yeah, what three drivers of use of wastewater irrigation is, one is limited availability of fresh water, especially in Gujarat, rapid urbanization and very reliable supply. Cheaper to lift, yes. If there are no electric connections, then wastewater accessibility itself becomes very profitable.
Thank you very much.